Good afternoon, everybody. I thank you for this nice introduction. I thank the chairpersons and my co-speakers. I thank the host, especially Dr. Bansi Sabo and his team, for asking me to be here in this DIACON. And I have excellent speakers have given talks before me, and I have Amit Bhai going to be giving his talk after my talk. And my topic is on vaccination in diabetics. Is it any different? And at the outset, let me tell you that it's a time to offer 2 minute silence to all those lives that we've lost in this unprecedented time. We had more than 22 crore cases globally, with more than 50 lakhs, around 50 lakhs deaths globally. We in India have somewhere around 3 crore plus cases in last 18, 19 months, and we lost somewhere around 4.5 lakhs lives. If we make very rough calculation based on this, in 18 months, if I have to look at 4.5 lives lost, which would roughly mean one life every 2 minutes. And hence, by the end of this 15-20 minutes discussion, we may have lost about 7 or 8 patients directly due to COVID. We believe equal number of cases would die because of COVID-related complications, those pulmonary fibrosis, those pneumothoraxes, those embolic phenomena, those mucor mycosis, and etc. And that would mean probably one death every 2 minutes again, which would mean we would be losing probably one patient every minute because of either COVID or COVID-related death. And there cannot be any better time to understand the importance of vaccination. If you go by herd immunity concept, and various mathematicians have given somewhere around 65 to 70% of the population have to get infected to get this herd immunity. And if we have to believe that, even if we take 1% mortality, you can imagine in 100 crore, if you take it roughly for calculation, there's 100 crore Indians, 60 to 70 crores will have to get infected, and 1% of that, if we have to compromise on those lives, that is going to be a very costly affair. And hence, along with social distancing, mask and sanitization, if something is going to work, that's going to be vaccine. We've lost 1800 doctors. That's what is the number that we have. I'm sure number may be more in the fight against COVID. That means almost 100 doctors every month we've lost in this crusade against COVID. We are nearing World Lung Day, which is on 25th, which we had on 25th September. And the theme was care for your lungs. Say no to tobacco, importance of vaccination, exercises, mainly the lung exercises, and clean air is going to be the message which was spread. I'm talking about COPD. We had 3 million people dying of COPD every year, and which would mean 5 people die every minute due to COPD globally. And again, by the time we finish our discussion, 75 odd people would die because of COPD. Coming to the topic for discussion today, that is vaccination. Vaccination is one of the most effective ways to prevent disease. It helps body's immune system to recognize and fight bugs, viruses, bacteria, and keeps it safe from disease that they cause. They protect against more than 25 debilitating or life-threatening disease like measles, polio, tetanus, meningitis, influenza. A lot of children somehow, very rightly, after so many efforts, receive vaccination on time, but still a significant number of children lose opportunity. And when it comes to adults, everybody here agrees that we are in very niche phase. We are in very early phase. We've just started talking about adult vaccination. Various societies realize the importance of this adult vaccination and have tried to stimulate all healthcare providers to think about vaccine whenever you have patients in front of you. The way we look at their pharmacotherapy, it is a time to look at their, like we give them advice regarding lifestyle, like we give them advice regarding diet and nutrition, role of physiotherapy and rehabilitation, we need to talk about vaccination. When I think about vaccine is a biological preparation which improves immunity to a particular disease. It is typically an agent which resembles a disease-causing organism. So it is either made from the weakened form of that bug, that bacteria, that virus, or it is killed form of that microbe. And it stimulates body's immune system to recognize this agent as foreign, destroy it, and remember it. That is most important. don't get carried away by those antibody levels. It is not the antibody levels which is there in your blood today, but it is the memory cell which remembers this and gives you protection when there is, whenever the immune system is again, you know, is threatened with presence of that bacteria, that virus, that bug. That is how the vaccines work. And you have two basic type of vaccines. You have a live vaccines and you have inactivated vaccine. Inactivated vaccines are of various types. We have, you know, DNA based vaccine, RNA based vaccine, we have vector vaccine. We have the full viron, which is inactivated, which may be heat inactivated, which may be chemically inactivated, or your virus particles, or you have a genetically engineered virus like particles, etc., to stimulate your immune system. And you have variety of diseases which can be prevented, like vaccine preventable adult disease. You have varicella, you have chickenpox, diphtheria, influenza. Influenza is going to be, you know, it's close to all chest positions, start, and I'm going to spend some time on it. Hepatitis A, hepatitis B, HPV, H influenza, measles, meningococcal disease, mumps, pneumococcal infection, rubella, shigella, tetanus, typhoid, whooping. Various diseases are vaccine preventable. And when you look at various guidelines, it talks about its use, and we have a lot of in-house guidelines. In-house guidelines in the sense we have guidelines which are developed by API. Luckily, I was fortunate enough to be part of the API module. IMA, I was part of that as well. IMA has also given live course immunization guidelines. Geriatric Society of India has given their guidelines. And we have a lot of international guidelines. We have Indian Chest Society, National College of Chest Physicians also giving their guidelines. And when I talk about immunization in a specific, that is high risk group, diabetes is considered as high risk group. When I look at the chart, you have various conditions mentioned, like you have pregnancy, immunocompromised status, you have osteopenia, you have heart or lung disease, a patient with underlying COPD, patients of transplant, healthcare professionals like you and me, homosexuals, and then there is a special column for diabetics, and all diabetics must receive all vaccinations which are available for adult population, which would mean you have hepatitis A, hepatitis B, you have a pneumococcal vaccine, you have pneumococcal vaccines are of two types, you have influenza vaccine, again influenza is live and inactivated, inactivated influenza is of various, like you have a trivalent vaccine, you have a quadrivalent vaccine, and then you have MMR, typhoid, etc. All this must be given. API very categorically said all healthy individual must receive DPT, MMR whenever they are elderly, influenza vaccine, anybody above 65 or with any, you know, these are healthy, they must receive pneumococcal vaccine and zoster vaccine. But if you have any high risk individual, they must also, in addition to these vaccines, must be offered hepatitis A, hepatitis B, meningococcal, varicella, typhoid, rabies, and encephalitis. Of course, it is not routinely indicated, but in the high population area or probably area where it is highly prevalent, must be offered this vaccine. And what we at API define as high-risk individuals is anybody with underlying lung disease. So whenever you have COPD, cardiac disease, hepatic disease, CKD, and then comes this diabetes, metabolic disease. So anybody with metabolic disease like diabetes, hematological disorders, even pregnancy, people living in nursing homes, household contacts of people with this kind of disease, all people who are on IV drugs, people receiving, you know, those blood and blood product concentrates, people with any chronic liver disease, all healthcare providers, anybody with any immunocompromising disorder, patient with HIV, osteopenia, hematological malignancies, etc., are all high-risk individual and must be given all these vaccines. Now, why the vaccination is not so well picked up in our country, in especially adult population, because unluckily there is no coordinated public health infrastructure. We don't talk about it, we forget about it, and many adults remain unvaccinated because they are unaware of the need for vaccination. And if you have to really increase the awareness, we don't have to only stimulate the healthcare professional, we'll also have to stimulate society. And there is considerable controversy. Again, the importance cannot be highlighted more during this time, where I'm sure every one of you gets at least one phone call a day from patient and your colleague doctors. Can you take COVID vaccine? Are there any contraindications? What are the side effects? And there is so much of myths which are prevailing about vaccination. Unluckily, to my mind, the biggest barrier is healthcare providers, you and me, our knowledge about vaccination. And our misunderstanding, misinterpretation of this leads to poor vaccination. We fail to understand about safety and efficacy of vaccine. We miss the opportunity, the right time when patient is most compliant, we forget to vaccinate them. Unluckily, vaccines are not available for free of cost when it comes to elderly population. And unluckily, we don't have publicly funded vaccine or reimbursement program. That also adds to the problem. And unluckily, there is no standardized format. Like you have any pediatrician, there is a big chart and big rubber stamp put about vaccination with all dates. Some of those things are lacking. I was talking to a couple of colleague physicians and I was trying to understand about vaccination. And you know, there are so many issues. A lot of us believe that insurance doesn't cover it. It is very costly. It is not needed. My patients don't like needles. There could be issues of biomedical waste. There could be issues of, perception that it is not needed for healthy individual. And when you talk to patients, they also have all these myths about it. And they said, I don't need it. I'm healthy. Vaccines may have side effects. And, I may contact disease once I take a vaccine. So these are the myths about certain, in population, in society. When I talk about specific diabetes, people with diabetes have somehow higher mortality due to risk of pneumonia and influenza. They are more susceptible. There are studies which say that they are more susceptible to severe H1N1 infection. Most of the people with type 2 diabetes will have associated comorbidities, that metabolic syndrome they'll have. They'll be overweight and it would make them vulnerable to getting influenza. And there are a lot of pathophysiologies, maybe hyperglycemia-induced immunosuppression with decreased neutrophil degranulation, reduced complement activation, maybe impaired phagocytosis, etc. could be responsible. But yes, they're at a higher risk of getting viral infections, more influenza. And in influenza, in diabetics, especially in overweight, they get very often secondarily infected with streptococcal infection, and they may present with streptococcal infection, and the mortality in that is very high. Of course, this disease has got high burden with underlying respiratory disease. Not only that, even underlying cardiovascular disease. You would be surprised to know that influenza could increase the risk of acute coronary syndrome in post-influenza phase, and you could have probably quarter of patients presenting with acute coronary event. And it has got huge economic burden. Trust me, the direct cost, the indirect cost, the hospitalization cost, the ICU cost of this disease is staggering high. I'll put next 5 minutes focus on influenza. Influenza belongs to Ortho-Mixidae single-stranded RNA virus, and it has got three antigens, type A, 1, and 2. It has got three types, type A, B, and C. And they've got two surface glycoproteins, that is hemagglutinin and neuraminidase, that is HA and NA. Now, HA is responsible for its attachment or its entry into the cell, and NA is mainly responsible for release of toxins and bringing about degranulation or lysis or the death of the cell. So you have type A, type B, and type C. Type A has got 16 types of HA, that is hemagglutinin of 16 types, glycoproteins of 16 types, and NA, that is neuraminidase, of 9 types, and various combinations of which, 16 of HA and 9 of NA, you get variety of different viruses, and hence viruses, they keep on changing their structure. And we are aware of these two terminologies called antigenic shift and drift. Shift is whenever there is a major change. So somehow you have two different viruses and there is genetic resortment occurs, and then there is the genetic mixture occurring and a new virus coming in. So there is a sudden major change in the viral structure and hence the emergence of new subtype, which results in a pandemic. Whereas antigenic drift is the smaller changes which happen in their structure. Small mutation happen, but somehow they don't change their HA and NA. That means hemagglutinin and NA structure does not change, but there is small mutation there, which happens continuously, and hence new strain which emerge every year. And you have a fantastic way of nomenclature. If you've seen this nomenclature, it says A stroke, probably the name of the place, the sequence number, the year into which, and then H1N1 or H3N2 or whatever. So it has got a which type is this, from where it is isolated, what is the strain number, which year it was isolated, and then comes the subtype, that is your H1N1 or H3N2 or whatever. And it not only has a simple viremic phase where you have a fever and myalgia and sore throat and cough and not much of sputum, photophobia, headache, so severe weakness, but it also leads to pneumonia. There may be cardiovascular complication, and yes, death. You lose significant proportion of patients. A lot of patients die due to influenza as well. And we tend to not differentiate it from simple cold. We feel that it is just a simple cold, and the importance of the severity is underestimated. Trust me, 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs death happen every year in the world because of influenza. We have the number of deaths we had during this COVID pandemic, somewhere around 4.5. We are losing equal number of patients every year globally because of influenza. And this is not for 1 year, for number of years it is happening. And influenza pandemics emerged for almost 100 years. I think 1918 was the first that I recollect, was Spanish flu, that is H1N1, which killed 50 million people. And since then, we had variety of small outbreaks versus pandemic. And the recent pandemic was 2009, when we had H1N1 killing more than 4 lakhs people globally. When I look at influenza, there are certain population which is at higher risk of influenza complications, hospitalization and death, and there comes your diabetes. So along with pregnancy, children, elderly population, patient with chronic medical conditions, patients of nursing home staying people with HIV and AIDS, comes a significant proportion of patients who have diabetes, especially the uncontrolled diabetes, especially the diabetic with metabolic syndromes. And hence, WHO and API recommend that every diabetic must take a lot of vaccination, including influenza vaccination. And this influenza vaccination must be offered to them once in a year. We know that there are various influenza vaccines available. You have a live vaccine available. You have an inactivated vaccine available. Live vaccine, by and large, is not much in use. We have a lot of experience with inactivated influenza vaccine. You have split, you have subunit vaccine, you have whole virion vaccine, and whichever vaccine is available in your area, whichever, looking at the cost constraint, availability, one could choose. They have a similar immunogenicity, in the sense the capacity to stimulate antibodies or the immunity is same. That means there is no advantage of one type of vaccine over the other. But yes, there is a need for adult vaccination. Vaccination must be recommended. One must put focus on vaccination program for adults. Healthy individuals must also take vaccine. Vaccination is not only for people with disease, but yes, when they have underlying disease, especially when they are diabetic, especially when they are COPD, especially when they have weaker immunity, one must not forget about this vaccination. I would end by saying that we at API has taken we have taken a lot of efforts in developing this vaccination module. So if you are interested, you could always write to API. We would be very happy to provide you a free copy of vaccination, which is where we have tried to look at vaccination. We have spoken about each disease, vaccination, type of vaccination, advantage of one vaccine over the other, advantage of different types of vaccine that you may have, like you may have a trivalent and a quadrivalent influenza vaccine, like you may have a various types of subunit vaccine or the split vaccine, split viron vaccine, etc., etc. And we've looked at various population which would benefit from this vaccination. So you have a special design for healthcare providers, people with underlying unhealthy lung, people with diabetes and other comorbidities, etc. We've also looked at age group. We've also looked at various situations where, suppose you're traveling or your child is traveling abroad. If somebody's from abroad coming to our country and you have a special gathering, like you have Kumbh Mela, you have various such gathering, what kind of vaccines to offer. I would end by saying that do keep vaccination in mind. Vaccination can bring about a big change. Vaccination can prevent disease, and prevention is not only cheaper than cure. Prevention is definitely better than cure. Prevention is definitely easier than cure. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. I am very happy to share with you that just last month, one of my paper got published in Frontiers in journal. It's an online journal available as frontiersin.org. And we looked at awareness, attitude, and current practices towards vaccination amongst physicians in India. And it was a cross-sectional study, multi-center study, and we feel that there is an urgent need for creating awareness in the current practices of physicians in our country. Thank you very much. Thank you for your patience here.